In early February of 1959, in the Northern Urals, in the vicinity of Holatsakhal Mountain, a group of ski hikers under the leadership of Igor Dyatlov disappeared. The first five bodies were discovered in late February, early March, and the remaining four in May. Since then, more than 70 versions of how the Dyatlov's group perished have been put forward. However, none of them can fully answer the following two questions. Firstly, why experienced hikers, physically well-trained and psychologically hardened, ran out of their tent, practically in their underwear, into the severe frost of the Northern Urals, and ended up more than 1.5 kilometers away from the tent? Secondly, who or what caused the injuries found on the bodies by forensic experts? Some of the hikers died from those injuries, while others froze to death after having been injured. Forensic experts concluded that the cause of death of three of the hikers was not freezing to death, but fatal injuries resulting from being hit by a blunt object while still alive. Death of Dyatlov's hikers? Kireev's version. You were a guest at the program of Channel 1 dedicated to the death of Dyatlov's group. I did not have a lot of knowledge of the subject, and I did not watch previous programs about Dyatlov's group. But that time at the program, I heard the forensic expert's commentary on injuries found on the bodies of hikers from Dyatlov's group, and I immediately had a clear picture of the tragedy that happened there. Regarding the mall, when the injuries of Lyudmila Dubinina, Nikolai Thibault-Brignol, Zolotarov were recounted and their parameters were told, such as that the injuries were caused by an object comparable in size to a human head and were aligned in a linear fashion, I immediately realized that such a mall was used to inflict them. The mole has several striking surfaces. Striking face of Kalatushka produces one kind of injuries, its edge another one, and its top a third one. I believe that Dubinina was hit with this side. The blow was aimed at her heart. This type of a blow is said to produce the reported outcome. A double fracture of the right ribs, a single fractured rib on the left, and a concussion of the heart, resulting in a struck person dying within 10 to 20 minutes. This is how the blow was dealt. If it were a plain overhead swing, it would smash all the bones to smithereens, the whole sternum would be crushed. And now I will tell you about this part here. The death of Mr. Thibault-Brignol resulted from a close depressed multifragmentary fracture of the cranial vault and base of his skull, which he suffered while still alive. Forensic expert was Возрожденный.
Если он лежит лицом сюда,
if he lies with his face turned this way, then you can see how the handle protrusion through the mole's eye would leave a characteristic indentation. The same was found during the autopsy on the skull of Nikolai Thibault-Brignol. This is approximately how the blow was dealt. The mole didn't have to be as big as this one. Nobody carries moles back and forth between one's home and worksite. When you are the local forest master, you just hang the mole on a branch of a Siberian pine tree and that's it. This is the way pine cones are knocked down with the mole. And the cones fall. All this reasoning resulted in my own version. Please notice that the bodies that were first discovered at the end of February had less injuries on them. That is, the bodies of Igor Dyatlov, Zinaida Kolmogorova, Rustem Slobodin, Yuri Krivonishchenko, and Yuri Doroshenko. The rest of bodies that had the most injuries on them Людмила Дубинина, Николай Тибо-Бриньоль, Семен Золотарев and Александр Колеватов were hidden away in a ravine in the hope that they would not be found until decomposed and consumed by animals. But something went wrong. A search operation was arranged. The military was brought in. It made it impossible to come and rehide the bodies. So the bodies remained there until May.
Шла еще речь об ожогах Юрия Кривонищенко.
About the burn suffered by Yuri Krivonishchenko, found near the Siberian pine tree, his body was bearing traces of injuries that can be interpreted as resulting from torture. The burns are concentrated on his heel and along the length of his leg up to the gluteal muscle. The burn is uniform, and its analysis demonstrates that the leg did not bend while it was burning. It is impossible for the leg not to bend while being burned. It's a reflex. The only way to achieve such a burn is to have a person suspended by the leg that is being burned. No human reflex is strong enough to bend the leg and pull the whole body up in such a case. Hanging a person from a tree and burning his heel is called torture, but it's the easiest way to quickly obtain information from an unwilling person while in a wintry forest. Today we repeated this experiment with a stuntman in the role of Krivonishchenko.
В чем, значит, цель вот этого подвешивания? Доказать, что, почему во время ожога нога оставалась прямая.
The purpose of hanging a person from a tree by his leg is to show how the person's leg remains straight while being burned. If a person is hung by one leg, then his own weight will not allow the leg to bend.
Приложи все силы согнуть ногу. Вот ты хоть что делай. Но парень молодой, физически подготовленный. Я, значит, озвучиваю мою версию, судя по тем травмам.
The spot with the heaviest burn on the body of Yuri Krivonishchenko is his heel. The fire was applied to his heel, but since his pants were wetted with cotton, the fire spread down along the leg until it reached his buttock.
Значит, продолжаем про ногу Кривонищенко.
Further about Krivonishchenko's leg. In order to understand how the flame spreads, we made a wooden model of a human leg. Now, we are dressing it the same way it was dressed when the body was found. We put on a sock, pants, and we hang it. This way, the modeling of the torture will be in full compliance with the recorded evidence. The pants begin to smolder. However, the goal of the person who applied the fire was not to burn the pants, but to deliver maximum pain in the heel area. How much pain can a person endure without telling the truth? I think it doesn't take too long. Let's see what effect it had on the leg.
Оплавилась пятка. Здесь, значит, у нас был.
There is an untouched part. The heel was burned down, but there is an intact area under the rope. As we continue to remove the pants and sock, we can see that the heel and the calf are burned. The conclusion is that the fire indeed can spread down along the pants fabric.
Тут хорошо очень пригорело.
Another aspect of the version is why Dyatlov's group ran out of the tent. That's right. We can't do a true-to-life modeling of the situation because we are dealing with living people now. But as for the reason, I think they experienced a sudden overwhelming panic. It reminds me of the way the SWAT teams work. Before any assault, a stun grenade is used. We did an experiment, but it didn't completely work out to properly simulate the situation of the Dyatlov's group in their tent. Despite the fact that our people were protected by gas masks and goggles, had knives ready to cut the tent, they still were consumed by panic. It is possible that the attackers simply made some noise around the tent and fired some shots, but to me it looks more likely that a smoke bomb was used to expel the hikers from the tent.
Ладно, начнем по-другому.
Why are you so interested in the story of the Dyatlov Pass incident? I realized that the weapon used to murder those guys was a wooden maul for pine trees gathering. It's been 60 years since the hikers were found, yet no one has identified the murder weapon to this day, even though it's such a ubiquitous tool. There is such a maul hanging from almost every other Siberian pine tree in those places. Are you planning to visit the Dyatlov Pass? If I have the free time necessary, I will go there in March to do a complete modeling of the incident.
Будем пытаться. Если не получится в полном объеме, ну малым составом как-то поедем.